Okay, welcome back. Good morning. Just as a brief reminder where we stand. I showed you yesterday how to conclude with a sweet argument involving path expansions, the decay of the fractional moment of the Green's function at high disorder. High disorder is very explicit, meaning that the product of the degree of the graph times a certain constant, which we computed explicitly, has to be smaller than the disorder parameter to the S. Now, we started to talk about how to get from decay of Green's functions to decay of the eigenfunction correlator. The eigenfunction correlator, remember, was the total variation measure, and that is the object which controls transport, which, when we prove exponential decay of this quantity, we immediately have things like no transport, that the fact that on this interval there's only pure point spectrum and all what we want. Okay, now, so in the first part of the lecture, and we are going to now concentrate on how to prove the exponential decay of the eigenfunction correlator given the exponential decay of the Green's function. Okay, now we went through sort of certain properties, and I stopped telling you that this eigenfunction correlator in fact can be viewed as a singular limit. Now we also somehow summarized that this relation, although sort of very neat and compact, is a bit hard to use because our bounds on the Green's function deteriorate in the limit S tends to 1, and the prefactor does not help. So the remedy for that is in fact to consider a family of eigenfunction correlators which will more easily be related to the Green's function. And that's what I'm going to start talking about now. Okay, so remember, the eigenfunction correlator, the total variation measure, if you're just dealing with a self-adjoint matrix, it was given by a quantity of this form when S is equal to 1. P of E is just the spectral projection onto the eigenvalue E. We're in a finite dimensional Hilbert space, so this is just a finite sum. Okay, and the generalization which I want to consider now is I'm weighting the off-diagonal matrix element of these spectral projections, which in case of simple spectrum would be just the product of the normalized eigenfunctions at x and y. I want to weight this in terms of the eigenfunction, the value of the eigenfunction at x modulus squared, because this is what the XX matrix element of this spectral projection boils down to in case of simple spectrum. Okay, now this parameter S, let me take it between 0 and 1, and notice that when I take, as I said, S equal to 1, I get back the original quantity. So this is the quantity which I want to control, it's the endpoint. Now at S equal to 0, this gadget here is a bit unsymmetric in x and y. As you can see from the definition, it reduces just to the diagonal matrix element of the eigenfunction correlator, so nothing else but the total variation measure of the spectral measure associated with that vertex. Now, there are a few of sort of interesting properties. Actually, I wanted to postpone some of those properties to the exercise session. They're all rather elementary. This is a log convex function. What is most important for us to understand the proof of this theorem, which I flashed just a minute ago, is the fact that once you control the eigenfunction correlator at some value of S, then you control it at the endpoint. Okay? Well, remember, we want to take expected values of this creature here, and just by Cauchy-Schwarz, this can be upper bounded by the square root of the expected values of the eigenfunction correlators at any intermediate parameter. Okay, so the task will be to bound the expected value now of this interpolated eigenfunction correlator. Now, how do we do this? Okay, and for this, I want to stay in finite volume. Remember, we talked about this lower semi-continuity of this eigenfunction correlator. So without loss of generality, I can always stay in finite volume. Okay, and the task will now be to relate eigenfunctions with Green's functions. Okay, and the basic tool for this is finite rank perturbation theory. The finite rank perturbation theory, I mean, we talked about briefly yesterday. It was flashed in this Krein-Feschbach-Schur formula, and I want to go into this now in a bit more detail. Okay. So the task will be to show this theorem, namely that this interpolated eigenfunction correlator is bounded from above by the expected value of the Green's function raised to the same fractional moment as you take a fractional moment of this eigenfunction correlator integrated over the energy interval you're looking at. Okay, and this completes then the proof of the high disorder result. Why? Because you just feed in the Green's function estimate. So let me somehow briefly flash this, although somehow it really doesn't need a big proof. Let me remind you that at almost every energy, the Green's function stays finite, even if you move down to the real axis. And we had estimates on the expected value of the Green's function of the real axis. They were uniform in the energy value. And therefore, the result carries over to the estimate of the eigenfunction correlator. Okay, so this theorem is the heart of proving our localization result. Okay, so how do you prove this theorem? Now, let me take a step back and let me recall from your basic even linear algebra class and some basic facts about eigenvectors and eigenfunctions in a Hilbert space. So if you have a self-adjoint operator, remember when you take a vector, there's in a finite dimension, there's a cyclic subspace spanned by the monomials acting on that vector. Okay, so if the dimension of the Hilbert space is finite, you may have learned in your linear algebra class that the span of these vectors, they generate the cyclic, so-called cyclic subspace of H. Now, what is the significance of the cyclic subspace of H in that vector? When you restrict the operator to these subspaces, then the spectrum of that operator is simple. Okay, so remember, somehow for matrices, you might have degenerate spectra, and you can remove this degeneracy by writing the original Hilbert space, say C to the n, if you're in the linear algebra situation, as a direct sum of cyclic subspaces, where you have simple spectrum. Okay, now this is also true in infinite dimensions. And if you're dealing with unbounded operators, it's a bit better to, in fact, work not directly with the powers of H. They might have a problem acting on a specific vector, right? We have to address something like a domain, something which I ignored completely in this talk because all my operators were bounded. But it's very healthy to take just the resolvent acting on that vector and take the resolvent somehow at an arbitrary value of the spectrum of the self-adjoint operator. Now, why am I bringing this up? Because as it turns out, it's an easy exercise that if you take a self-adjoint operator H naught, let's talk about matrices. If you take a self-adjoint matrix H naught, and you consider a rank one perturbation. Okay, so my notation then before a projection onto the vector spanned onto the vector delta x irgendwie is this physicist notation cat bra, and v is just a real number. So this is a rank one perturbation of this self-adjoint object H naught that the cyclic subspace of H naught associated with this vector delta x is the same as the cyclic subspace of the perturbed operator associated with the same vector. Okay, so cyclic subspaces and we don't change and be under rank one perturbations. Now, in rank one perturbation theory, you know irgendwie that, or you may recall, and that's the purpose of this slide, that if you know the spectrum of H naught completely, then you can determine everything about the spectrum of the perturbed operator. At least when you restrict everything to the cyclic subspace generated by the vector associated with the perturbation. Okay, and that is the content of this well-known theorem of which summarizes rank one perturbation theory. And let me somehow illustrate what's written there. Okay, remember one of the exercises which I asked you to do yesterday was to compute in such a situation the resolvent of the perturbed operator HV. When I say resolvent, I mean the diagonal matrix element in that specific vector delta x, which we're considering here. Now, what was the answer? Well, the answer was that as a function of v, this depended in the following way on v. So there was a v minus an object, which I called alpha of z. Let me call this object, in fact, sigma naught of z. And it's not hard, if you go back to your notes, to figure out that this sigma naught, in fact, has to be the inverse of the resolvent of the unperturbed operator. Well, see, if we set v equal to zero, if there's any truth in this formula, then minus sigma naught has to be the inverse of the resolvent of H naught. Okay, so sigma naught of z is nothing else but minus 1 over delta x, 1 over H naught minus z delta x. Okay, so what does that entail? Well, it entails that once you know everything about the spectrum of H naught, you can read off the spectrum of HV, at least if you restrict to the subspace which you can reach by applications of resolvents to this vector, to the cyclic subspace generated by delta x. Okay, and the picture is the following. That let's look at how what this formula tells us. You see, what is the spectrum of H of V? It's those Zs at which the resolvent blows up. Okay, so when does the resolvent blow up? Well, it blows up exactly at the location where V is equal to sigma naught of E. Right, it's those energies for which sigma naught of E is actually equal to V. Okay, how does sigma naught of E look like? See, if you look at how sigma naught of E looks like, so that's E, and that's sigma naught of E. Right, so what is sigma naught of E? Well, sigma naught of E involves the resolvent of H naught, and the resolvent of H naught is just the sum over the spectrum over those eigenvalues of H naught of Ej naught minus E times the mere weight, and the weight is just the normalized eigenfunction at location x squared. Okay. So clearly, I mean, this function as a function of E has poles exactly at the eigenvalues. Now these poles will then turn into zeros of sigma naught of E. Okay. I can write down E1 naught, E2 naught, E3 naught, and so on. So let's suppose it's a 3x3 matrix. And sigma naught has a zero in here. Okay. Now, this function here as a function of E is of this shape. So that if I would draw it, you know, you have these singularities things will move from minus infinity to plus infinity when you move from one eigenvalue to the next eigenvalue, right? So what does that entail? Well, it entails somehow that there must be a zero of these creatures here. So there would be any sort of zeros. And at the zero, somehow of these guys, sigma naught blows up. Okay. So basically, the picture is the following, that we have a blow up, it goes through zero here, and so on. Now, you can think about somehow what the asymptotic value of this creature here is. When you go to minus infinity, this function here goes to zero, right? And it goes to zero sort of near, now get it right, then near plus infinity, and since we sort of put a minus sign, we get negative infinity. So it goes somehow down there. And likewise, if you go to plus infinity, this function here goes to negative infinity, and then we also somehow go to plus infinity out there. So that's a rough sketch of what sigma naught looks like. And the task of finding the eigenfunctions of this perturbed operator is now extremely simple. You take your V. That's your level set V. And you just read off from where this function crosses sigma naught, where the new eigenvalues are. Okay, so in this 3x3 situation, I have my perturbed eigenvalue, the third one here, the second one here, and the first one here. And note something which you might or might not have learned from your rank one perturbation theory, which is worth taking away, namely that these perturbed eigenvalues always intertwine with the unperturbed eigenvalues. Okay, so that's somehow one of the basic features of rank one perturbation theory. If you've never seen that, independent of your interest in random operators, that's something worth taking away. Now, we can actually say more. We can even construct eigenfunctions of the perturbed operator. Now, and here is the basic message, namely, the eigenfunctions of the perturbed operator actually turn out to be the Green's function of the unperturbed operator. Okay, why is that true? Well, let's see. So, but how do you check that this is an eigenfunction? Well, I apply hv and me to this function phi e at x. Okay. So hv was h naught minus e acting on v, and we just spits out and with the vector delta x. Okay. And what remains is nothing else but a plus v times now the vector delta x multiplied by what? Multiplied by the diagonal matrix element of the resolvent, of the unperturbed operator. Now, but notice that 1 plus v times this negative inverse of sigma naught just happens to be 0. So that's the proof of the second part of this known theorem. Okay. Now, but that somehow even entails more. It entails that you can compute the spectral measure associated to that vector delta x of the perturbed operator at every eigenvalue, right? What you have to do, where the spectral measure, recall, that's your spectral analysis, that's just the weight of the resolvent, okay? And the weight of the resolvent is always given by the normalized eigenvectors. Now, I gave you eigenvectors, and I told you that the spectrum is simple, okay? So there cannot be somehow another eigenvector associated to it, okay? So that's why here is the proof. Here is nothing to prove. That you just need to normalize the vector phi e of x in order to get the weight of the spectral measure at this eigenvalue e. Now notice the following: that this quantity here actually happens to be the inverse of the derivative of sigma naught. Okay, you just take a derivative on sigma naught, and you see that it agrees with that. So one way to remember this formula in a just more catchy way, in some sense, is to say that the spectral measure of the perturbed operator, okay, that is nothing else but a Dirac measure, which is generated by the locations v. Did I put a plus or a minus? Minus sigma naught of e. Okay, that's one way to summarize my third point. Okay, where this is just somehow the usual Dirac delta distribution. Okay. That is an important observation because it gives you a one-line clue of a basic theorem in random operator theory, and that's the spectral averaging principle. Now, what is the spectral averaging principle? Well, the spectral averaging principle is the observation that once you integrate the spectral measure of this rank one perturbation over V, then what comes out is Lebesgue measure. Right? There's nothing to prove here because we just already proved this. Once you integrate over V, that's it. That is the famous spectral averaging principle. Okay? Now, of course, it's easy here because we're working in a discrete situation. It can be generalized to continuum operators. A lot of what I'm talking about can be generalized to continuum operators. And it was first invented actually by Cotani already in 84 in the situation of one-dimensional random Schrödinger operators. And Simon later sort of cleared this up. In fact, it was the key to prove pure point spectrum before people went the effort to go through the eigenfunction correlator proofs. And that was done by Simon and Wolf in 86. Now, it is also the core of something which you might have heard people talking about, and that's these famous Wegener estimates or non-resonance estimates. I want to pause for a second to give you a three-line proof of that. Now, what is this? Well, take your finite volume operator, so take a finite graph, where H is just a matrix, and ask yourself the following question. Take a Borel set I, and ask what's the probability that in this Borel set there's at least one eigenvalue. Okay, so you can express this, and we are saying that the trace of the spectral projection is larger or equal than one. Now, you're all probabilists, so Chebyshev's inequality is not alien to you. So let's estimate the probability in terms of the expected value of this quantity. Now, what is the trace? The trace of the spectral projection of this operator, and it can be evaluated in any basis. Now let me take my favorite basis associated to the lattice sites, this delta x. See, and what you see here is, this is nothing else but the spectral measure associated with x in this Borel set I. So just taking the spectral, spectral averaging principle, and notice that for each lattice site we have an independent random variable where we can integrate over, and where we can somehow apply exactly this corollary here. Well, not exactly. There's a distribution, and one of the reasons why I wanted an absolutely continuous distribution with a bounded density is in some sense to formulate these kind of results, right? So once I integrate over sort of rho omega x d omega x of this guy, I can throw out rho omega x with the infinity norm, and the rest is just an integral of the form of this corollary. It gives you the length of this Borel set, the sum here remains untouched and leads to the volume of the graph. That's a proof of the famous Wigner estimate. Okay, let me now go back after these digressions to address how you, using rank one perturbation theory, relate the Green's function to this eigenfunction correlator. And the core is the identity which I'm just flashing here, which is sometimes known under the name resampling principle. The idea is that instead of the original random operator on our finite graph, we're just considering a random operator in which you change the original potential at x to another value, namely, let's call it nu. Okay, so you resample the potential at this lattice site. That's the idea. This resampling is helpful because the eigenfunction correlator of the original operator is then related to the Green's function of the resampled operator, modified by some weights which involve the shift in the potential. Okay, and that's an identity. Now, how do you prove this? Well, remember, the eigenfunction correlator. Maybe I should go back. Let me somehow briefly flash back here. The eigenfunction correlator involves these spectral projections associated with x and y in the diagonal ones, right? But we now have formulas for those guys, because we have our rank one perturbation result, the rank one perturbation result tells you that the spectral projections are one-dimensional. Okay, at least if you restrict everything to the cyclic subspace generated by x, but that's what we're doing, because we're considering everything on vectors delta x. Okay, and we have an explicit formula for how the corresponding eigenfunction looks like. It's the Green's function of the unperturbed operator. But in our application, the unperturbed operator is the operator which I want to look at. Okay. Okay, so so what you have to notice, that in the spectral subspace, which is the cyclic subspace generated by delta x, where the spectral projections have positive weight, these ratios of spectral projections are just given by the ratios of the Green's functions. That is what rank one perturbation theory told us, right? But and that was at an energy where the unperturbed operators inverse resolvent just hits the new potential value. But if you go back to this formula, that is the Green's function, and at those energies where E is in the spectrum of H, the inverse is just given by the inverse of Vx minus V.
Yeah, V is new or compared to
That's new, yes. Sorry. Slight typo. Okay? And then you just plug it in. Okay? You just somehow plug the ratios of these spectral projection which you have in the left hand side you just plug it in. Now the mu of x that you can view as a sum over the eigenvalues of H with the weights which are exactly given by the XX matrix elements. But that is the object where you're summing over. So you take this to the power s, right? This gives you these two factors here, and you sum over what's in the denominator over E. And that's encoded somehow in this spectral in this integral over the spectral measure associated with x. That's the full proof. Now let me use this identity now. Okay, so how can I use this identity? Well, let me first condition on all the randomness apart from the potential at x. So in other words, let me just integrate over omega of x because we're in the IID case. Okay, so who depends on omega of x? Well, the way we chose our perturbed operator is in such a way that we resampled the potential at x. So the operator h nu does not depend anymore on omega x, right? Because I subtracted v of x in here. Okay, so this part here is independent of omega of x. Okay, so what depends on omega of x is the potential. Okay, and what depends on omega of x is, of course, the spectral measure associated with x. Good. Now, how do we integrate over the spectral measure? Well, that was our spectral averaging principle. So if we get rid of the dependence of omega of x here, we're in good shape, okay? Because integrating over the spectral measure, that's easy. That gives us Lebesgue. Okay, aside from somehow the distribution of the random potential. So let me just somehow get. Write this integral as an integral over omega of x and take the supremum over somehow all possible values of omega of x. This is u. Now I'm taking here the potential because this is nothing else but omega of x, and for convenience I've just set lambda now equal to 1. Okay, so so this gives us this expression. And integrating over the spectral measure with the spectral averaging principle gives us Lebesgue measure. But that is cool because now we took just one integration in order to relate the interpolated eigenfunction correlator to an average over a Green's function. The only problem is now it's not the Green's function of the original operator, it's the Green's function of the operator of the matrix where the potential at x is resampled to nu. But nu is now free, it's at our choice. So we just take nu to be distributed in such a way that once you integrate over nu, which sometimes in here is V in my slides, then it just gives the original probability distribution. And that's what completes the proof. Okay? So that's the whole trick. You just exploit rank one perturbation theory to relate the eigenfunction of the original operator to a Green's function of a resampled operator. You use the spectral averaging principle, and then you complete by averaging over your resampled potential. Okay, it's a very somehow simple step. Okay, now this completes the first part of this lecture, because we now proved that. Remember some of the transparency which I flashed at the very beginning. We now prove two things which I flashed on this transparency, namely that if you take lambda very large, that there's no pure point spectrum. This we prove by means of the Rage theorem and by proving first a bound on the Green's function, which was exponentially decaying, and then going to the eigenfunction correlator. It proves immediately no transport, because the eigenfunction correlator bounds the transport. So the next thing which I thought might be interesting to you to learn is how do you conclude Poisson-level statistics, and what is Poisson-level statistics in this regime up here at high disorder? And that's somehow the few slides which will complete the lecture today. Where am I now? Here am I. Okay. So what is Poisson eigenvalue statistics? So the question which we're asking is, we take our favorite Anderson model, now on my favorite graph, and let me take ZD. And out of this graph, I carve out a box of dimension L. And I just consider the operator H, this Anderson model, just restricted to this box. Okay? And now this is now a matrix. And as such, it has discrete eigenvalues. These eigenvalues are random. Okay, so if this is the energy axis and you have discrete eigenvalues. And when L tends to infinity, of course, these eigenvalues, they will accumulate and they will form the spectrum of the Anderson model. Now, question. What is the typical, so this is of course a random process, what's the typical distance of the eigenvalues? Okay, just 3 minutes ago, we talked about a Wegener estimate. Okay? Remember, the Wegener estimate somehow said that if you're in finite volume, and we are now in finite volume, the average of the number of eigenvalues of HL is what? Well, it's at least bounded by a constant times the interval length, also in I, sorry, I'm just considering now an interval here. It's bounded by a constant times the interval length times, L to the d, because that's the volume. Okay? So, let me write, to be consistent with my transparencies, let me write the volume of the box here. Okay? So, in other words, the eigenvalues, they cannot cluster closer than somehow one over, as a distance one over the volume. On average. Okay, that's what this Wegener estimate tells us. But that means, if you now take the limit L tends to infinity, it's a wise thing to just say we fix an energy and consider a box. Not a box in space, but consider an interval. which has the size of several multiples of 1 over the volume. Okay? Now, and focus on what happens somehow in this energy interval centered at E. Now, how do we do this? Well, we just rescale the original process of eigenvalues, which I called En. We rescale it by the volume. And we then consider the random point process, which is just associated with these rescaled eigenvalues at E. And this now has a chance of converging in the limit L tends to infinity, because the typical distance of eigenvalues is 1 over the volume. Okay. So let's consider this random process. That's the associated random measure. We can first, when we ask about properties of this random process, we can first ask about mean intensity. And the mean intensity, that is the question which is written down here. Now, it turns out, and that's something which I didn't talk about, there's a quantity which in random operator theory always exists, and that's the so-called integrated density of states. Okay, that's a measure, let me call it nu, associated with a Borel set, which emerges as the limit of the box size going to infinity of the normalized trace of the spectral projection of these finite volume operators. Now, as it turns out, you may have, okay, so remember this trace is just a sum over the volume of these gadgets here. So it might not be sort of totally alien to you to suspect that this limit, which is a spatial limit because of the ergodicity of our underlying process, in fact exists and is non-random and is given by, in fact, because of spatial homogeneity, by the expected value of, say, take any lattice side of the spectral projection of the infinite volume operator, where x can be chosen arbitrarily. Okay, and that is a non-random limit. And what you prove here is you prove some sort of an ergodic theorem. Okay, let's take this for granted. Now, one of the first things which we can say about this measure, about this integrated density of states measure, is that because of Wegener's estimate, it is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. And in fact, given in terms of a density, and let me call this density also little nu of E, and that's physically the so-called density of states, which appears, oops, there's an expected value missing here, I'm very sorry, which appears clearly somehow in the limit of this mean intensity. If this thing here converges, the only chance, if it converges, is to converge against the density of states. Okay. Now, of course, one has to be a bit careful. There's a whole industry asking about regularity properties of this integrated density of states measure. And what Wegener's estimate shows to you is that this integrated density of states measure, if you define it as such, is of course absolutely continuous with a bounded density. But that doesn't mean that the density itself is regular, is a continuous function. Okay, so this could be still a very choppy function. No reasonable person would expect this. And in certain situations, one can actually prove that this is even analytic. But in general, one doesn't know. So in order to sort of write down something like that, of course, I have to be a bit careful and restrict to the Lebesgue points of the density of states. That's the points which are defined through the usual limiting process, that once you take some of the derivative of this measure, this limit exists. Okay. Now, what's the big deal in random operator theory? The big deal, which also relates to another topic, which is a favorite here in Saclay, is integrable systems and chaos. And there is a conjecture in this community, which is known as the Berry-Tabor versus Bohigas Giannoni-Schmidt conjecture, which Stefan can actually explain to you in much more detail. It basically says that once you take a classically integrable system, so an integrable billiard, and you consider its quantum analog, then if you look at the spectrum of this quantum analog and randomize with respect to energy, then the process which you will see there is a Poisson process. Okay. Now, conversely, if we take a billiard which is classically chaotic, then Bohigas, Giannoni, and Schmidt conjectured that the quantum analog actually shows level repulsion, and even more, the eigenvalue process, which you obtain by randomizing over the energy window, is the same as the eigenvalue process which you know from random matrix theory, namely the Gaussian orthogonal ensemble. Now, in random operator theory, there's an analog of this conjecture, where the integrable phase is the localized phase, and the non-integrable phase would be the delocalized phase. And the conjecture, the so-called spectral statistics conjecture, is the following, that the spectral characteristics of this infinite volume operator, which we took the Anderson model in our case, is reflected in the behavior of the process of eigenvalues in finite volume. And once you go into the regime of localization, this eigenvalue process, as I defined it on the previous slide, should converge to a Poisson process. Once I would go to the regime of extended states, which remember is there in greater than three dimension at sufficiently small disorder, then what you will see when you consider this process numerically is you actually see a GOE ensemble, okay, corresponding to eigenvalue repulsion. And if I go somehow to more complicated random operators which involve magnetic fields, I might even see GUE or other ensembles. Now, what I want to do is give you a proof of the first part of the spectral statistics conjecture in the random operator setting. Okay, and that is a result which goes back to Minami in the 90s, which is formulated under the following condition. And we suppose we are in the regime where we can prove a fractional moment estimate on the Green's function. So we do have such an estimate because once we look at large disorder in arbitrary dimension, the fractional moment of the Green's function, they decay exponentially uniformly in the energy parameter which I'm considering it sort of up in the complex plane, and also uniformly in the volume. That is what we proved, at least at high disorder. Okay. And Minami tells you that once you go to energies, so once you take this experiment and we sort of take an energy, zoom into the energy interval of size 1 over the volume, and take the limit L tends to infinity, then this random process converges to a Poisson process with intensity given by the density of states. That is the result of Minami in the 90s. Okay, now I think I'm speaking to probabilists, so I'm probably carrying coals to Newcastle, but let me nevertheless remind you that there's a standard way of identifying a Poisson process. So how do you prove Poisson process? So what did they teach teach you in your probability class. Well, you know, one way to prove that something somehow is a possible process is to prove that it's infinitely divisible, that you can identify it as a sum of independent and random processes, and they are all negligible. So arbitrary many, but independent and random processes. So what you have to do is you have to identify somehow these random instances here as being created by light rain, independent, many of them, and all negligible. Okay, that is essentially what this theorem says. But there's a little footnote which you should also take care of, is the infinite divisibility is not quite sufficient for a Poisson process. You have to prove that the process doesn't include double points. Okay, so let me read now the theorem with you after having said this. So if you have a triangular array of random processes which are all independent for each n, for each step in this approximation, and you know that in the limit n tends to infinity, they are all negligible, in the sense of somehow that once you take a finite window and you ask, is there a point in my finite window? Then uniformly over all these independent copies in the limit n tends to infinity, the answer is no. Okay. Now, secondly, you exclude something happening which is not so nice, which is double points, namely that the probability that in your energy interval I, there are more than two points, that is actually even summed over all of the processes, that is going to zero. Remember, somehow we are thinking of considering the sum of these independent rains which we're creating through this triangular array. Now, and the third condition is that, well, we have to fix the intensity of what comes out, and that is the middle line here. It says that, remember, since the probability that more than two summed over everything goes to zero, you can view this as saying that there's somehow one eigenvalue in here, and then this clearly somehow represents the mean intensity of the process. Okay, and under these conditions that you have independent rain of points, they are all negligible, no double points occur, you fix the intensity, then indeed the sum of these point measures, the convergent distribution to a random point process with a given intensity measure mu bar. That's the reminder. Now, let me give you the physicist's proof of the theorem, which is in fact also, which can be made then into a proof. So what we want to consider is the process of rescaled eigenvalues. So this mu, what is it, E L is equal to the sum over n delta lambda L E N L minus E, where these are the eigenvalues of H L. Okay, so how do I approximate this random point measure by something which is independent and which will be asymptotically negligible? Well, very easy. I just take the original box, which has a dimension L, okay, and I cut it into smaller boxes, which have a dimension L to the alpha, where alpha is smaller than one, but still positive, so that these are not finite boxes. In the limit L tends to infinity, they also grow to infinity. Okay. Now, if I somehow repeat this picture, so So the idea is then to approximate this given random measure by the sum of random measures of all the boxes. ML is the number of boxes. And each box gives rise to an eigenvalue process. These are my eigenvalues E, N, L in the box J. Okay. And the important thing is to observe that, you know, if I ask somehow where, on which scale does this process live? Well, probably I have to use some other chalk. Okay. So if I ask somehow for each J, there would be somehow an eigenvalue process of these E, N, L, J's. So on which scale does that process live?
E, N, L, J corresponds to Hamiltonian restricted to a small box?
To a small box, yes. Well, it's again one over the volume, but the volume now is much smaller. So that's 1 over the volume of the smaller box. And remember, I want to take the smaller boxes large, so of size L to the alpha. So this is L to the A, and the full size is A. So typically, if I consider somehow an interval of size 1 over the big volume, then in such an interval, I can indeed expect that there is just 1 eigenvalue of the orange process. Okay, that's the idea. Okay, so indeed, that is the right direction, as you can see from this little picture. Now, what about this approximation sign? So what is the danger here? Well, the danger is the following, that, you know, in this big box, there are eigenfunctions of the operator on the big box. These eigenfunctions, they are localized. You know, the localization length of the eigenfunction, since the eigenfunction resembles the Green's function, the Green's function is localized on order 1. So the localization length here is just order 1. Okay, that would be an eigenfunction of HL. So typically, this eigenfunction doesn't fall onto any of the cut lines which you're introducing by segmenting the box. So if you ask among the eigenfunctions which you're considering in this window, how many are there which are falling somehow, which are perturbed by, severely perturbed by this process of cutting, well, it's the eigenfunctions which live in the vicinity of these cut lines. But that's in comparison to the volume, of course, a negligible fraction. Okay? So in some sense, I can now go home, right? Because I showed you the proof idea. Because that's it. You know, you just have to somehow approximate this, and you have to apply this standard result in how to prove Poisson process, and then we're done. Well, let me nevertheless sort of go through the details, and there's actually a beautiful estimate which you also still have to prove, which concerns the exclusion of double points. Okay, good. Now let me see, how much time do I have? I think half an hour, right?
Yes.
Yes, I think that should work, yes. Okay, so there's a to-do list of things which you have to go through. The first part of the to-do list is to make sure that the object which obviously somehow fits the description of this null array in our abstract theorem indeed approximates our original point process. Okay, and That's the first lemma. So if I take the linear dimension of the small box, this is L to the alpha, with some alpha which goes actually smaller than 1, that's again a typo. And if I'm in the localization regime, then indeed the process can be well approximated by the sum of processes, meaning that most eigenfunctions just don't live in the vicinity of the cut lines. Now, how do you let me show you how do you prove sort of in detail such an estimate. Well, this is a state.
The right hand side of the limit should be 0.
Ah, that's 0, yes. Okay. Sorry. Okay. See. Okay, so that's 0, yes. So how do you prove this? Well, you know, just take a convenient class of functions which are dense in L1. One of the most convenient classes of functions are functions which are related to the Green's function, because the Green's function we have under control. Now, the Green's function is the resolvent, right? And something which is dense in L1 is the imaginary part of the resolventish function. Okay, so this you probably better know under a Cauchy-Lorentz distribution, and prove that this is equal to 0 for g equal to phi of z, where z is just somewhere in the upper half plane. Now let me compute the difference. Okay. What is actually the difference? Well, I did the computation for you. As I said, somehow when you evaluate the measure on these functions, out pops the resolvent. Well, it's not the resolvent, but the imaginary part of the resolvent. And you have a sum over all n. The sum over all n may be converted to a trace. So that's this quantity. Now let's look at the scaling. You see, if I take this function phi of z and plug in the rescaled process, then all eigenvalues are multiplied by the volume. Right? So what pops out here is the difference of the operator minus e times the volume. But since this is 1 over x, I can just pull out the volume. And this gives me a z modified by 1 over the volume. Okay, so that's just the first part. And the same argument goes for the second part. Okay, where the difference, of course, is that this trace is over the whole universe, and this trace is just over the box J. Now, but the trace, I can also compute not only in the eigenbasis of the operator, but I can also compute the trace in my favorite eigenbase, which is associated with the lattice sites. So this is done here, and notice, since all of the boxes, and we sum up to the big box, this trace here can be thought of as a trace over a sum over the smaller boxes and then summed over all boxes. Okay, and then you take the diagonal matrix element of the resolvent and its imaginary part, but that's the Green's function. Now, at which energy are we evaluating the Green's function? We are evaluating the Green's function at energy E, where we focus our window, plus a bit of possibly imaginary part, so a complex value, which will collapse to real, to sort of zero when L tends to infinity. And that's also the reason why somehow controlling the difference is not entirely trivial, because you need to control the resolvent or the Green's function near the axis. And you need to show that these quantities here, even when you sum over everything, are close to one another. Why are they close to one another? Well, see, let's... Okay, so that reduces the problem to one box, just fix J. And in one box, you can think as follows. Well, most of the summation here over x in the box is just in the interior of the box. And there's only part of the vertices, and we are on the boundary. Now see, once you take an x, which is in the interior, so an x here, that's the interior part of the box, Lj, then that is the second part here, which I wrote up. Once you take an x which is in the interior, the boundary is far away. Well, because we have the liberty, since these boxes grow with L, we have the liberty of somehow enlarging the boundary layer, growing also with L at a smaller rate, right? And then it's clear that sort of, I think, intuitively clear, but that's something which I want you actually to prove in the exercises, because that's a cool application of localization, that once you're in the interior, the difference of these Green's functions, that can be controlled by the distance of interior vertices to the boundary of the box. Okay, so that is where the localization estimate goes in. Now, what are we doing with the boundary layer? Remember, we have a 1 over the volume in which we can kill. So one way to deal with the boundary layer is to just forget about cancellations and just estimate it by the number of terms in the worst case. The good thing is that the expected value of the imaginary part of the Green's function, that's a bounded object. Now, that's a bounded object. Why? Well, because, you can just integrate over the random variable at x. Just take the imaginary part of such a quantity. Now, this gives a Cauchy integral, and that is finite. Okay, because somehow each of these terms here, in its dependence on omega of x, that was one of the basic messages of yesterday, is of this form. And you can integrate over omega of x. This will have, when z is in the upper half plane, this will have a positive imaginary part because it's a Herglotz function as a function of z. And therefore, the integral of the imaginary part is certainly finite. Okay? So we can throw away somehow these all of these terms and just have to count the number of vertices which are in the boundary layer, and you can engineer things in such a way that the ratio of the number of terms in the boundary layer to the number of terms in the small box of course goes to zero when L tends to infinity. So we can just neglect it. Now, an exercise which is really somehow a cool exercise to prove once you want to understand how to work with localization is indeed to prove that the second part is bounded in terms of the distance to the boundary. And in essence, I would ask you for the exercise session to prove that if you disregard the imaginary part, just take the difference of resolvents over nested boxes. Then if you're in the interior of the inner box, then the decay of this difference is always towards the boundary of the interior box. Okay, good. So let's finish the proof. So we had these three things which we needed to check in this abstract theorem. There was the nullity of the array. Well, that's clear. That is this picture here. As I said, that's done by the Wegener estimate. If you just take one of those processes, which remember, you are scaling it by the wrong volume here, not by the natural volume, but by the wrong volume. So you're considering everything just in the 1 over big box environment of the fixed energy, and there's just at most a negligible, I mean, number of eigenvalues, how many, where that can be estimated by the Wegener estimate. Okay. So that counts in with the number of eigenvalues in our interval, and that goes to zero with the number of boxes. Now then you need to fix the density. That is something in me which I don't want to talk about. That's actually also in me sort of an easy exercise to prove this from the fact in me that we are at a Lebesgue point of the density of states. And then comes in me somehow in me this second in me fine print in me that Poisson processes are infinite divisible processes which have no double points. So what we need to estimate is the probability that there are two or more points falling into the interval of the Diddle process associated with the box J. Now, how do we do this? And here comes a cool estimate which is known in this community as the Minami estimate. In the way I've written it down, it entails the following, namely that the probability when you ask for what's the probability that there are m or more eigenvalues falling into this rescaled interval, that is by a Chebyshev bounded by the product, and this product is bounded by something which goes to zero. Now let me show you what's the machinery behind such estimates. And that's my last slide. It's the following extremely cute observation which really goes back to Minami. Minami had a miracle calculation using rank 2 perturbation theory, but in fact, as it turns out, here's a five-line proof of this same result, which was later found by Comte-Germiny and Klein, which I think is so cute that it's worth presenting it because it also relates to rank 1 perturbation theory. So what is the statement? Well, it's a statement which generalizes Wegener's estimate because it asks, so take an operator on a finite graph of the form which we looked at, namely some operator like the adjacency matrix plus IID random potential, and ask what's the probability that in our given interval I, we have more than n eigenvalues. Okay, claim, well, for n equal to 1, I showed to you by Wegener's estimate that this is bounded by the volume of the graph times the interval length times a constant which involves the distribution. Now, the observation by Minami is that when n is equal to 2, this probability actually scales as a product. So it gives, at least as an estimate, the bound which you would get if the eigenvalues would be independent. Okay, if they are n, then indeed the independence bound still holds true. That is what this theorem tells you. Okay, and using this theorem, we can plug it into the abstract result. Now, how do you understand this theorem? Well, see, computing probabilities or bounding probabilities is always hard, so let's Chebyshev it. How do you Chebyshev it? Well, just take the product of those creatures here, always subtract subtract j running from 0 to n minus 1 and n factorial. Okay. Now, this bound then follows if we can show by induction that this product of factors in expectation is in fact bounded by the product of the volume and the interval length. And remember, in case n equal to 1, that is what we already showed. Namely, the expected value of the trace is bounded by volume times interval length. Okay, so now let's prove this somehow given that we've proven it for n, concluded for n plus 1. And that goes as follows. Okay, where's my picture? Here's my picture. Okay, now, so we're at n plus 1. So the sum ranges now from 0 to n. And I'm going to separate the factor corresponding to j equal to 0 from this product. Okay? Now, condition on all random variables aside from the random variable at side x, that's this omega x, which we have at this lattice side. Why do we want to do this? Because we can write out this trace which was sitting here as a sum of diagonal terms, my favorite basis. Now, if this nuisance here wouldn't be there, we could just use spectral averaging to conclude that this factor here is bounded in terms of the interval length. And we would get a volume here. Okay? So we would get an interval length by using some sort of a spectral averaging. Now, of course, that doesn't work, because all of this product here contains in a very complicated way the dependence on omega of x. Okay? Now, but we don't want to compute things, we want to upper bound things. And now look at the picture. So think about this idea of resampling. Now, what happens if I change the potential value at x in these terms to just some other value? What happens? Well, it's a rank one perturbation problem. And you know what happens under rank one perturbation. So you have the original eigenvalues, and there will be new eigenvalues. But the new eigenvalues are intertwined with the original eigenvalues. So once you take somehow an interval, and you change the potential to some other value, the number of eigenvalues in this interval, it can only be changed by 1. Okay, that's exactly this picture, because independent of how large V was, this eigenvalue which is created between the original eigenvalue 1 or 2, it can never overtake 2, even if V is driven, even if V is driven somehow to plus infinity, right? And likewise, this eigenvalue here, it can never overtake this value here, even if V is driven down to minus infinity. So eigenvalues under rank one perturbations, the number of eigenvalues is bounded by 1. One of the other ways to express this is to say, under rank one perturbation theory, the spectral shift function is bounded by 1. That's a claim which I'm sure you've heard, if you followed a course on operator theory. But that's cool because it means that this product here can be changed at least upper bounded by the product in which we just increase everything by 1, right? We resample the whole thing. Well, I should have put here a hat or something saying that this holds true for the potential at x put to some other value which I don't care. This gives me the opportunity to integrate over omega of x the factor which is bounded by spectral averaging and which pulls out a factor of the interval length. Once I condition on omega fx now, but then I have somehow the resampled value free again, and we do the same trick as before. Now let's put it back to the original value and integrate over it, and that restores the old problem. That's it. Isn't that beautiful? And that basically concludes the proof of this Minami estimate. So it's not, in fact, a rank two problem as in the original paper, but it's just based on the observation that rank one perturbation theory entails that the spectral shift is bounded by 1. Now, let me finish this lecture somehow with talking about directions in which you can go into now, if you would be really interested in pursuing the subject further. Now, I've talked about localization at extreme values of the disorder strength, but if you go back to my original phase diagram, I claimed that also at extreme energies, namely near the bottom or the top of this almost true spectrum, there's localization. Now, how do you prove this? Well, the answer is basically by a proof technique similar to what we've seen, namely what remains to be proven is an exponential decay of the Green's function, because the rest of the machinery I showed to you. I showed to you how to go from Green's function to eigenfunction correlators. So once you can prove an estimate on the Green's function, you're done with the machinery. Now, there's the original proof of Anderson localization, which mathematicians came up with, was complete localization in one dimension. And in fact, even this can be done from the present machinery now, because what you have to show is that the Green's function decays exponentially. Now, in one dimension, something curious happens to the Green's function. The Green's function actually happens to be a product of Green's functions, which themselves sort of form a Markov process. And you can use techniques from dynamical systems, for example, to control this product and prove that things actually decay exponentially. Now, one of the big open problems is to prove complete localization in two dimensions. So, as I mentioned yesterday already in a private discussion, the thing to prove here for probabilists is in fact the Mermin-Wagner theorem. Because what does localization entail? Localization basically entails of decay of correlations. So if you're in a statistical mechanics setup, you want to prove that the high temperature phase prevails down to lambda equal to zero. And the technique which you usually show this by in statistical mechanics is Mermin-Wagner type techniques. And that would be very good to get a grasp on. Okay. Now, any of those proofs will not prove sharp bounds to the phase boundary in higher dimensions. Remember, starting from three dimensions, we expect a regime of transport popping up. And if you investigate all of our localization proofs and compare them to numerical results by physicists, then of course they are not sharp, but they can actually be made sharp by a technique which is also known from statistical mechanics. Goes under the name of finite volume criteria. Essentially, the proof which I showed to you was this idea that, remember, the decay of the Green's function was concluded by saying that in order to go from here to here, from x to y, I eventually have to leave x and then do something on the complement of that side. Now, this could be called, or is sometimes called, a single site criterion. And you could imagine now renormalizing this proof and arguing, well, in order to go from x to y, I eventually have to leave a box of site length L. And if you have more information about the properties of the Green's function from the center of the box to the boundary of the box, of the full Green's function, that it might enable you to concatenate these steps and conclude from properties in a finite volume properties of the infinite volume Green's function. Okay, that's the idea of these finite volume conditions which were developed around the year 2000. Now, there's a completely different technique which I also mentioned, which is multiscale analysis, which is a bit more robust than this fractional moment method. It also, for example, allows you to deal with not only truly random operators, but operators with a pseudo randomness as in the almost mature or other type problems of this type, and that's multi-scale analysis. In essence, what you need to show is some sort of an estimate. The logic behind it is the same, right? You try to prove in some way that the Green's function, maybe in finite volume, from a site to the boundary decays. But that will not be true for all boxes, because there will be resonances. These are somehow these resonance spots, which I talked about in the very beginning. And these resonances, we have to be taken care of by a probabilistic estimate in case of random operators. And that's usually done by a Wigner estimate, which, as you saw, is closely related to the finiteness of fractional moments. Now, delocalization is another topic which one could talk about. There is something known, but only on tree graphs, that has been pursued somehow in the early on as the 90s, and in the complete picture. I copied Sims, but by Michael and me a few years ago. of course, the real task, but that's probably the most complicated problem in this business, is to go down from infinite dimension, which are trees, to any finite dimension. I think somehow, if I should give an advice to youngsters, that is probably a much more doable problem than this one. You might risk your career by thinking about this one too heavily and not getting anything out. Surprises are always there. Now, there are various other exciting stories which go with random system. And one of the exciting stories is actually the quantum Hall effect, where you know that once you put an electron in a perpendicular magnetic field in a two-dimensional structure, then the so-called Hall conductivity is quantized. And the amazing thing is that this Hall conductivity is quantized even despite the fact that when Klitzing measured this effect originally, he measured it on very dirty samples, and we saw on disordered structures. So disorder doesn't destroy this effect, but actually it enhances this effect, and it's responsible in some way for the quantization of this Hall conductivity. That was a story which was also pursued in the 90s. And you're very welcome to read more about what I talked about today in the book which Michael Eisenman and I somehow authored just 2 years ago. Okay, so I think the plan would be that I'll hand out an exercise sheet to this part of the lecture, and tomorrow I'll go into more current topics. As you've seen, somehow everything which I talked about was in principle already known back in the 90s. So the question is, what are people currently working on? And that's a bit related to this many-body localization, which I want to go into tomorrow.